Brad Keselowski's days at Team Penske may nearly be numbered. A rival organization has offered Keselowski ownership of their team. How's it going, y'all? My name is Eric, and welcome to Out of the Groove. Lots to get to today. It's Tuesday, so that means Show and Tell Tuesday will return at the end of this episode, but we've got a lot of news to get to before then. Be sure to check out the latest from the Out of the Groove podcast network, latest from the NASCAR Weekly Podcast, a lifetime in NASCAR for you history buffs out there. Be sure to check out the latest episodes, and Noah Talks NASCAR, of course. You can find all of the latest from the Out of the Groove podcast network down in the description below. We will get to the mail here shortly, but we've got a bombshell to react to this morning. Remember like 3 days ago when I made the comment that this year's silly season just wasn't super interesting to me? I was more interested in how, you know, the charter system was going to play out. You know, would Junior Motorsports be able to get a charter? Would 2311 expand? That was the more interesting part to me. I'm eating those words this morning because silly season just took a hard left turn, like even hard for NASCAR. The leftmost of left turns. Jim Utter from motorsport.com reports this morning that Brad Keselowski could become the next owner driver in NASCAR. According to motorsport.com, Brad Keselowski has been offered a full-time Cup Series ride with Roush Fenway Racing beginning next season in a deal that would also include part ownership in a renamed team called Roush Fenway Keselowski Racing. Whoa. Goodness me, how many more names can they splice onto the back of Roush? It was Roush, then it was Roush Fenway, now Roush Fenway Keselowski. It's like a legal practice, just adding more names to the sign. But anyway, large and unwieldy team names aside, this is huge news that has the potential to rock the NASCAR Cup Series world. According to this motorsport.com report, it said Brad Keselowski has been offered the number 6 car for next season, which means it's likely that Ryan Newman is out at Roush Fenway Racing. He could be retiring at the end of this season. That is obviously a possibility, but I'm not going to speculate too much there in this episode. Brad Keselowski is in the final year of what was just a 1-year extension with Team Penske. He's already got a win this year, winning at Talladega a few weeks back. Keselowski signed that 1-year extension last year after the pandemic had hit and likely hurt the driver market. I think Keselowski was looking for a long-term, expensive, wealthy extension. Did not get it from Team Penske last year, partially due to the uncertainty the pandemic created. So this year, Brad Keselowski once again is technically a free agent. He is clearly testing the waters. There are multiple reports saying that Brad Keselowski is talking to several different race teams. Roger Penske said a couple months ago that he was in negotiation with Brad Keselowski about a contract extension to stay at Team Penske. Clearly, those negotiations must not be going very well if Keselowski is weighing other opportunities, including this huge opportunity with Roush Fenway Racing, which we're going to focus on here today. There are a couple different questions that should be asked regarding this story today. First off, what is Roger Penske doing? Right now, Penske maybe has the best all-around driver lineup in NASCAR. They're only a 3-car team. We're not going to talk about the Wood Brothers so much, but you know, Brad Keselowski, Joey Logano, Ryan Blaney, any one of those drivers could pop off and contend for a championship. I mean, last year, just a few months ago, both Logano and Keselowski were in the championship four at Phoenix. Why would you want to split that up? Brad Keselowski is a former champion. He's won at least 3 races every season for the last 5 years. Been to a couple championship fours in that same time frame, so I think you could make an argument that he is the best and most consistent all-around driver Penske currently has in their lineup. And that includes Matt DiBenedetto at the Wood Brothers or Austin Cindric, who we know is moving up to the Cup Series level with the Wood Brothers next season. The one thing I guess he's got going against him is that he's 37 years old, which makes him by far the oldest driver in Penske's control at this point. But I mean, look around. Martin Truex Jr., Denny Hamlin are both 40, and Truex is dominating this year. Kevin Harvick's like 45 and still at or very near the top of his game. So Brad Keselowski probably has at least a few more years of top tier or very near top tier production ahead of him. It's nowhere near the same as when like Joe Gibbs Racing let Matt Kenseth go in favor of Eric Jones. You know, at the time, Matt Kenseth was 45 years old. You know, even as a Matt Kenseth fan, I kind of get it. I wasn't happy about it at the time, but I get it. 45 year old versus a 20 year old who's winning a bunch of Xfinity and truck races. I understood why Joe Gibbs was willing to let Matt Kenseth walk away in favor of the younger, cheaper, promising Eric Jones at the time. This is not one of those situations. Brad Keselowski is 8 years younger now than Matt Kenseth was at that point, and Kenseth was still winning at 45. So to say Brad Keselowski's got nothing left in the tank is obviously wrong. So I don't know what Roger Penske is really thinking here. Maybe he's blown all his money on Blaney and Logano, getting them extensions the last few years. Maybe with Austin Cindric, you know, Tim Cindric's son, who works high up within Penske. With Austin Cindric moving up to Cup next year, presumably still with the Wood brothers, even if Keselowski leaves, I assume Cindric is still going to go to the 21. I think that's already kind of ironed out at this point. Maybe there's space at Penske for Matt DiBenedetto. I know a lot of Matt DiBenedetto fans want to hear that. That doesn't really make sense to me. You know, I like Matt DiBenedetto a lot. There's few guys in NASCAR that I want to see succeed more than Matt DiBenedetto. I want to see him do well, but I mean, the results have not been remarkable the last year and a half, let's just be honest. Matt DiBenedetto would be a clear downgrade from Brad Keselowski. That's not a slight against DiBenedetto. Keselowski's a future Hall of Famer. I'm just saying, it would obviously be a downgrade in the short term and maybe the long term. And he doesn't bring any sponsorship that I know of, so I just don't know what Roger Penske is thinking here, letting Brad Keselowski walk away. Perhaps the price, they just couldn't meet somewhere in the middle on that. Keselowski asking for too much, Penske asking for too little. Perhaps the number of years in the contract that they've been negotiating wasn't to Keselowski's liking. Maybe he wants a 3-4-5 year deal, and Penske likes these 1 and 2 year deals, you know? I don't know where the hangup is, but I'm looking at Roger Penske thinking, man, how can you not hold on to Brad Keselowski? Anyways, that's the first question. What's Penske thinking in all this? I don't know. My second question here is, would Brad Keselowski even fit as an owner at Roush Fenway Racing? Well, I think this is a pretty easy one to answer, actually. Brad Keselowski has owned a NASCAR team already in his career. I mean, he owned Brad Keselowski Racing, BKR, a truck series team primarily, from 2007 till they closed in 2017. And in that 10, 11 year span, they won 11 races with drivers such as Austin Cindric, Chase Briscoe, Ryan Blaney, Joey Logano, Brad Keselowski himself. And that team in many ways helped launch the careers of successful drivers today, like Tyler Reddick, Cindric Briscoe, as I mentioned, Blaney as well, Daniel Hemric, even Roush Chastain. So Brad Keselowski has been in the team ownership game before, and he's worked with some very talented and helped foster some very talented young drivers. Brad Keselowski also owns a manufacturing company. After BKR closed in 2017, in the exact same building, as a matter of fact, Brad Keselowski opened Keselowski Advanced Manufacturing. I'm not going to pretend that I know anything about that industry, but it sounds like it's been successful and it continues to grow. I read an article where they're planning to double their workforce this year, so that sounds like it's going pretty well. Brad Keselowski has said that he wants to stick around the sport beyond his driving career. Last year, Brad Keselowski said, "I don't want to just leave the sport behind. I would like to still be able to have a reason to come to a racetrack other than just to watch. What that will be in the future, I don't know. I can't sit here today and say that I have that answer." So Brad Keselowski has expressed interest in still being involved in NASCAR beyond his driving career. He's owned a race team before. He owns another big business here today. It's clear Brad Keselowski is ownership material. So the question of, would Brad Keselowski be a good fit in an ownership role? I think the answer is yes. But now we finally come around to the $1 million question. This all stems from a report that says he's been offered an ownership gig, a driver ownership role at Roush Fenway, just offered. He hasn't accepted, nothing like that, just an offer. My final question is, should Brad Keselowski take this deal? Now, unless Roush Fenway president Steve Newmark is watching, none of us know the specific details behind this offer. We don't know, you know, what percent stake in the company, in the team Brad Keselowski has been offered. You know, the Fenway group, which is now also partially owned by LeBron James, has a stake. Roush, Jack Roush still, of course, has his stake. What percentage would Keselowski be offered? It has to be a significant percentage if they're gonna add his name to the sign. But we don't know specifically, we don't know the financial details behind it, we don't know all the additional incentives behind it, so it is difficult to make a fully educated decision here or argument here, but in my opinion, just looking at this from 100,000 feet level, I think this opportunity is coming at a near perfect time for Brad Keselowski. Brad Keselowski is 37 years old. I know I've been saying this whole episode that that's not that old, he's still got many years ahead of him, and he does. But let's be honest, he's got young children at home. He may not want to be on the road 3 days a week, 4 days a week, assuming practice and qualifying come back in their full glory next year. He may not want to do that for more than a few more years. He may not want to do that well into his 40s. So being an owner would allow him to work closer to home more frequently and maybe only be out on the road at the track 1 or 2 days a week, really as much as he pleases. But another key factor in this is the next gen car. The next gen car is expected to at least somewhat level the competitive playing field next season. All the race teams will be getting the exact same chassis from the exact same places. Gibbs will be getting the exact same race cars delivered to their shop that Spire Motorsports gets. Well, I guess theirs will have a Chevy nose gives up a Toyota, but the car, the frame, all that's coming from the same place. The biggest teams with the most money will probably continue to find competitive edges and will still likely do most of the winning, but I think it's safe to say that that gap, the gap between first and 30th, is going to shrink somewhat next year. So Roush Fenway Racing, a team that, you know, did make the playoffs in 2019 with Ryan Newman, and right now they have Chris Buescher inside the top 16 in points. They're not a bad team, but they're certainly more of a mid-pack or maybe a B-minus or C-plus tier team. They might catch up slightly next year just via the introduction of the next-gen car helping level part of the playing field. So if Keselowski goes and drives for Roush Fenway next year, I think he'd be a playoff contender, absolutely. I don't think he'd run 20th or 25th most weeks. I think he'd be in the top 15 more often than not. That's just my guess. I don't think it'll be as fast as anything Penske puts on the track on a regular basis, but it won't be as far off as it may appear to be now. At least that's my hypothesis. That's my guess. That's many people's hypotheses, if you will. Anyway, so Keselowski is a young family, may not want to be on the road too much longer. Roush Fenway Racing is primed to catch up a little bit with the next-gen car. Also with the next-gen car, it's expected to be cheaper to own a race team in the long run than it is today. So more financial incentive perhaps to get in now while the going is good. That's another reason. And the fourth reason I think this is a big opportunity is Brad Keselowski could take on a major, major role within the company before long if he chooses to. You know, Steve Newmark is the president of Roush Fenway Racing. A lot of them are handling the day-to-day operations over there. Jack Roush is still around, still very much an influential figure, but he is 79 years old. How many more years is he going to continue to be around Roush Fenway, going to continue to have his hands on it? An absolute legend of the sport, but before long, I think guys like Brad Keselowski will have the opportunity to fill in some of those gaps how they see fit. So before long, Brad Keselowski could have a very influential role within Roush Fenway Racing if he takes this job, and if the stake is as high as it seems, given that they're putting his name on the door. So a young family, slightly more competitive cars with the next gen, perhaps cheaper costs associated with the next gen, and the ability to have a lot of influence and a lot of say within the organization. All of that, that package, that seems like a pretty complete package for a driver who's 37 years old in the back half of his driving career, and who wants and said that he wants to stick around the sport in the long term and continue to compete, even if it's not from behind the wheel. I think this would be an awesome move for Brad Keselowski. I mean, I'm sure Brad Keselowski fans would love to see him stay at Penske, because if he stays at Penske, that gives him the best shot at contending for championships the next couple of seasons. But if Roger Penske's not willing to give him that multi-year stability, not going to give Brad Keselowski the opportunity to maybe retire with Team Penske, I think this could be a really great option. From a personal standpoint and from a long-term standpoint, if Keselowski wants to still be involved in competing in NASCAR at 65, it's gonna be through owning a race team. And we've talked on this show plenty of time in recent weeks about how difficult it's gonna become to break into the NASCAR Cup Series as a brand new team owner. You gotta get that charter. A charter even has to be available. You gotta find one. Brad Keselowski's basically being handed a completed, ready-to-go race team. Again, he's not the majority owner or anything, but he'll have a say, he'll have a role there. This could be exactly what Brad Keselowski is looking for. It may not look like the best opportunity today, because today, I think Brad Keselowski's focus is still on winning races and championships. But 10 years from now, 20 years from now, if Keselowski takes this deal, I think it will have been a good thing for him in the long run. But that's just my opinion. Again, not knowing all the specific details behind the scenes. Again, if they're gonna put his name up there alongside Jack Roush's and the Fenway groups, if they're gonna put Keselowski's name up there, again, Roush Fenway Keselowski Racing, what a name, it must be a pretty hefty stake in the race team. That might make it worth it to me. I know Keselowski wants to win championships here these next few years. He might still be able to contend with Roush if the next-gen car really does even the playing field, even more than I'm predicting. But boy, heading over to Roush Fenway Racing could absolutely cement your legacy, your longevity within the sport. Brad Keselowski will be an influential, important figure in stock car racing for years and years to come if he works with a team like Roush Fenway Racing. That's just my take. This is going to be super interesting to see how it plays out. Both Roush Fenway and Team Penske refused to comment when Motorsport.com reached out to them, so we'll see what comes out of this. Oh boy, silly season just got that much more interesting. I regret everything I said last week about this year's silly season falling flat, being boring. I was wrong, and it did not take long for me to be proven incorrect on that one. Now, it is Tuesday, so we've got another edition of Show and Tell Tuesday on deck. Just a few things to go through this week. Thank you all so, so much for sending things to my P.O. box. That address is down in the description. I really enjoy Show and Tell Tuesday. I really enjoy seeing, you know, relics of the past or things that I've forgotten about and kind of forcing me to do research on and talk about and share with you guys. I really like Show and Tell Tuesday, so I appreciate those of you who have been participating. We've got this first box here from Casey in North Carolina, and ooh, it's a hat. First, a note. Eric, here is a real number 17 hat for you. Wear it on one of your race review episodes, and I bet it will go down as one of your most watched episodes. Okay, all right, or hopefully that comes true, Casey. Oh my, they said 17 hat. I was expecting Matt Kenseth, but no, it's Darrell Waltrip Motorsports. Oh my gosh, look at this Darrell Waltrip 25th anniversary. This is a super cool hat. I like it. This is like, you can tell this was probably made in like the 90s because it's like chrome colored and like chrome was considered super futuristic and modern and stuff. It also matches the door numbers on many of Darrell Waltrip's paint schemes through the years. So this is a really nicely themed hat. Darrell Waltrip Motorsports. Some good and bad times with that team. Waltrip won a few races driving for himself in the 90s. And then the team, my friend Danny B did a good video on it. The team closed down in the 90s, but then their truck series operation kept rolling. Anyway, this is a really, really cool hat. Try it on, it doesn't really match my outfit. Oh gosh, and my hair is extremely poofy and I have a huge head naturally. Oh yeah, get that thing in the light, get that shine, get the chrome just right. Thank you, Casey, really, really cool. I'm gonna keep this on the rest of the segment. Got an envelope from Kenny in New Jersey. Ooh, oh my gosh, just a bunch of hero cards, it looks like. Yes. Oh my gosh, Tony Stewart on a chopper. Oh wow, these are super interesting. Oh, Casey Kane, gotta get one for Casey Kane as well. All the ladies love that face. Oh, Matt Kenseth, 2001, looking sharp as always. Oh, this one's upside down. Dale Jr., Monte Carlo. Oh, look at Dale Jr., mean mug in there. You're not fooling anyone, Dale. Come on now. Oh, I like this one. Speaking of Roush, that is a cursed Carl Edwards 99 font. Didn't see that for very long. Yeah, two 99s. Jeff Burton's still on here as well. That's a little weird. This is really, really cool. This is like when I got into NASCAR and, you know, I was a Matt Kenseth fan, so I kind of pulled for all the Roush guys. This brings me back. There's one still in the envelope. Miss Sprint Cup, there you go. What year was this taken? You got Kim Kuhn there on the right. Pretty cool throwback. Thank you for sharing these with us, Kenny. Elliot in Tennessee sent a bunch of things. Looks like a bunch of trading cards. Gotta catch them all. What is that? What is that Matt Kenseth on the dollar? Oh, and on the back. Oh, what is this? Whoa, wait, what? Is this a real dollar bill with Matt Kenseth covering George Washington? Like, I salute you, Matt, General Kenseth. This is so random. What? I mean, it looks actually really, really good. But why? I have to ask why? Why this? This has to be the most valuable dollar bill in the world. Anything with Matt Kenseth's face on it, oh, priceless. Brad Keselowski, Chase Elliott, these are all pretty recent. Take a look, yeah. Oh, and he even made a little Matt Kenseth fan art card. That looks really cool, actually. That's awesome, I like that. Hand drawn, really, really impressive, Elliot. The dollar bill sent me though, I really was not expecting that. Lastly, we have a box here with a note attached from Aaron. Doesn't say where he's from and I didn't see it on the box, but Aaron sent a very, very nice letter. A fellow Matt Kenseth fan, I tip my hat to you. These things are wrapped up, but Aaron sent, it looks like a couple of diecast cars. Here's the first one. Whoa, the Trex car. This is one of the first 1/64 scale cars I ever had in my collection. I probably still have it someday. I've never seen it in 1/24 scale. Matt Kenseth ran this scheme at Atlanta in 2005, I believe. I'm not sure if he ever raced this anywhere else, but it always stood out to me. The silver on the nose, the black on the back, kind of like a stealth scheme. Oh, this is a trip down memory lane, Aaron. This looks really, really cool, really, really sharp. Oh, and the second one, this is not one I have either. Wow. Ford Fusion on the front, and the Gen 4 Ford Fusions just look kind of strange to me. I don't know why, that just looked weird. But this is a beautiful looking race car. I always loved the black number 17 numbers on the yellow door. When they put the yellow number on a black door, I didn't always like that quite as much. This looks really, really sharp. He mentioned in his note, I don't know if you can see those red scuffs on the door, but he said his brother took a Casey Kane car when they were younger and would like rub them, like run them into each other. And he said he thought it was funny because Casey Kane finished second to Matt Kenseth so many times during their respective racing careers. So that is a nice, charming touch. I appreciate you sharing these with us, Aaron. A real trip down memory lane for us Matt Kenseth fans. Really appreciate it. That is going to do it for this week's edition of Show and Tell Tuesday. I hope you all enjoyed. Let me know your thoughts down in the comments below about Brad Keselowski. Should he take that deal deal with Roush Fenway? Should he continue to look elsewhere for something else? Let me know down in the comments what you guys think. Big, big news today. That's gonna do it for this episode. Be sure to subscribe if you're new to the channel. We talk NASCAR every single day here on this channel. As always, a huge thank you to my amazing Patreon supporters as well. I couldn't do this show without your continued support. I really do like this hat, especially when you get it in the light and the chrome hits it just right. Real throwback look. I like that a lot. Thank you all so much for watching. I will see you in the next episode. Have a great rest of your day.